Hey guys, welcome back. So now, with Getting Into Death Metal Part 5, like, prior to this point, we've been talking a lot about Antichrist, but this issue truly brings all of that home. And also here, most of what we covered with the tie-ins, they fall into the main event, and I'll just point those out as we go along. So with that being said, let's get into it. But first, if you're new to the channel, be sure to subscribe to catch the spills every week, and don't forget to hit that bell up top, so you can squat up in the comments for the first hour. Alright, so jumping into Death Metal Part 5, it picks up right where we had left off with the origin of the Robin King, with him going up against the Trinity and showing off the artillery which he collected to face his versions of them on his world, and a lot of which we saw that he didn't get to use against his version of the Trinity, so for the most part, it was like a I can't let this go to waste type of situation. But when we jump in here, all of that's already taken place, and the Robin King is taunting Wonder Woman with a medal that was presented to the Diana of his Earth after giving a speech about continuing the fight and never give up, like always fight because there's tomorrow. But with the Robin King who has his medal, one, it tells you that that didn't end well, just off of the fact that he has it. But on top of that, he then goes on to say that he booby trapped it with needles from the God Killer sword to kill his Diana, and implying that he's going to use it on this one. But before he's able to, it's here where he's taken by the Darkest Knight, who then takes the Robin King back to his homeworld, where all the Groblins, who we had usually seen with the Batman Who Laughs at the time, where they would usually say nothing but crow. But it's here at this time with what we had seen in the Robin King's origin, when he had inadvertently gained influence over the Groblins. Like, this is the time where it kicked in, so the Darkest Knight took him over there. And once again, very much feeling like a passing of the torch from the Batman Who Laughs to the Robin King. But also at this time when the Darkest Knight leaves, he calls for Castle Bat to hold out the heroes until it's time. And prior to this point, we had known that Castle Bat was sentient from like what we had seen in Speed Metal, but it's not until now where it physically turns into a Batman, to whom I imagine sounds very much like Optimus Prime. But also with facing Castle Bat, you have an amalgamation of everything that could be found throughout different locations of Gotham and the Batcave as well, being that Castle Bat is another nightmare Batman within itself, to where in this case, this Bruce Wayne did a spell that spread his soul throughout Gotham City. And although like on the surface, the idea itself, it sounds like the cover of a mixtape. Like, it's pretty ridiculous. But at the same time, it's also very OP because everything that Castle Bat uses against them, it also has like a deep cut Gotham reference. And for that reason, there's something here that can take out everyone. But before it gets to that point, it's here with the conclusion of Doom Metal, it then makes its way here into Death Metal, with Lex Luthor arriving and using modified Brainiac tech to transfer the soul of this Bruce Wayne from Castle Bat into Snow Globe. And like, as soon as he does this, he hands it over to Harley Quinn for not so safekeeping, and he tells her like she can do whatever she wants with it, she can step on it, and clearly she ain't need to hear nothing else besides that. But then it's also here where you have your final fight between Perpetua and the Darkest Knight. And aside from the changes that the Darkest Knight had done with Earth Zero, Earth 49 is like your last Earth left, or at least until Perpetua tossed it at the One Who Laughs, so pretty much sure they're all dead now. But while this is happening, like, this is the fight that determines what happens to reality. And at this point, there's no turning back with the biggest two ambitions for what should be next going head to head, with the One Who Laughs going for the Multiverse Who Laughs, or Perpetua with her vision of a world of apex predators who would live forever. But at this point, with Lex taking the heroes inside of the Legion of Doom headquarters, he lets them know, like, straight up, Perpetua's gonna lose. But even with that being the case, he has a plan. And really with what it's come to now, like, the heroes, they don't have a choice. Cause now it's like either give Lex a chance, or just stand around waiting for the next wave of Nightmare Batman to come through. And they already know that the latter is not an option because things didn't go so well with Castle Bat, and if that was the case, like what are they gonna do about the Darkest Knight? So for that reason, they have to hear Lex out, and more or less just trust that he's leading them in the right direction. Because prior to this point, as far as just intentions and motives with Lex Luthor, we know that everything that he's done up to this point, it's mainly been done with the motivation of first getting his revenge on Perpetua, but then also getting the opportunity to restore himself as the Lex that he believes that he should be. And from what we've seen in Doom Metal, we're kind of put in a place to where we're led to believe that Lex Luthor has had a change of heart, and like this is his second opportunity to do something different from what we have seen in Justice League No Justice. But even still, at the same time, this is Lex Luthor. So going forward in this event, keep an eye on this guy. But it's here in part 5 where Lex explains to the heroes like his idea is to actually go small rather than saving everything with this huge amount of crisis energy. And with breaking it down, he tells them this story about when he was a kid in Smallville and how back at the time he would always run down to the science museum and watch a film about the great beginning, about the Big Bang and how it formed the stars and eventually life and the whole universe. But one day somebody working at the place was real lazy and they unintentionally played the film in reverse, which scared little Lex, causing him to see everything in the universe become undone, all the way up to the intro, which read the great beginning. But then it's here where we get more detail on what Lex had sent Lobo to get, which had been one of the hidden shards of Metal X, which after Dark Knight's metal, the monitor had hidden away the remaining pieces in different levels of reality, which is why Lex approached Lobo to go get it, with knowing that he has insane regenerative abilities, like fully reforming from a drop of blood. But it's also here where they contest the idea of going at the one who laughs with Metal X, which is the same thing as Element X, which we had seen in Dark Knight's metal, which was then later called 10th metal towards the conclusion. But it's here where the heroes are like, what we use on Barbados is not gonna work on the one who laughs. And Lex lets them know that that's not his plan, but rather the plan is to fight the one who laughs with the truth. And he tells them, like, ever since Perpetua was locked away, a lot of the truths from the universe, they had been hidden as well. And through the years, many brave people have tried to uncover these truths, and they built different machines to seek it out. And for the past few months, Lex Luthor had designed one of these machines as well. And at this part, like, though it's not specifically mentioned, I do believe like much of this information that Lex has, with the exception of what he stole from Carter Hall, but I believe that much of this information that Lex has, he had also collected with what he had found out about his father, who was one of the most successful of many over the years at studying the totality, but then also understanding that there was more to it. And though at that time we didn't get a reference to anyone building these machines like Lex has described, but we do know at one point in time his father, Lionel Luthor, was manually seeking those truths, which is then also what led Lionel to discovering the hidden forces of Perpetua, the Tear of Extinction, the Graveyard of Gods, the Sixth Dimension, and more. But like we'd seen, Randall Savage had wiped Lionel Luthor's mind, so he didn't get to use any of that. But Lex, on the other hand, with the help of Brainiac, he did get his father's studies, so it makes sense that Lex has a bit more insight. But then it's here where Wonder Woman asks Lex more questions about the machine, like how does it work? Does it redirect crisis energy? Like, what are we doing? But really it's here where we get the truest definition of this anti-crisis, air quotes, that we've been talking about this whole time. And with using the Lasso of Truth to demonstrate, Lex reminds Diana that the people are the source of the crisis energy, which is born of their fears and their desires to be big, but then when the crisis occurs, the memories up to that point is tied in a knot, moving forward into that newer continuity, or reboot. But on the flip side, anti-crisis energy is created through people's memories of what had happened before, which then unites people, bringing them together and effectively untying these knots that were made through crisis. And this is what Lex's machine is designed to do, with producing this anti-crisis energy to go up against the one who laughs. And initially Diana's like, look, I tried that already, back when she had battled Perpetua and burned out the sun. But she quickly then realizes that Perpetua had tricked her by causing Diana to doubt, which then allowed Perpetua to use that fear and doubt to her advantage. But right after realizing this, Diana then comes to the conclusion of some hints which we've gotten throughout Death Metal, and because of that, she then goes directly to Batman and Superman. And Batman is the first one to spill the beans. He's like, I'm dead. I've been dead. And it's crazy seeing that, because I remember some of you guys in the comments and even on Discord was saying that early on when we had seen Batman show up with a Black Lantern ring, you're like, oh, he's already dead. And at first I was kind of like, I don't know. But then when he got shot by the Darkseid Batman and he lived, that was kind of like grounds for like, okay, let's reevaluate the situation. But then in the case of Clark, like, he knows like his condition is not reversible, like he can feel it. But even still, both Superman and Batman, they both agree that they'll do what they can moving forward. And for part of this plan, like, Wonder Woman asks Lobo like if what they say about him is true as far as his regeneration, which he can do from a drop of blood, which is their solution to the part of her plan which requires a lot of soldiers. But it's very quickly that we find out like the solution to this anti-crisis, it's not like a plan to save everything. And we get that rock solid confirmation as soon as Superman goes back to Themyscira, which is where all the villains were imprisoned. And initially when he arrives, they're thinking the same thing, like, you're breaking us all out to save the world. But Superman then quickly corrects them, like, no, the plan is to destroy it. And it sounds pretty messed up on the surface, but at the same time it's almost like their hand is forced, because they have to deprive the Batman who laughs from crisis energy. And then more or less, fingers crossed, if everything goes well, they'll be able to undo everything with Lex's machine. And I kind of feel like at this time, like, Lex has gained their trust, because he did kind of give the example with The Lasso of Truth, and I mean, we didn't see him tie the knots in it to know for sure if he touched it, but it really seems like that's why they're leaning so heavily into Lex's plan, and just ready to destroy the whole world with the strong belief that Lex is not capping. But with Superman taking all the heavy hitters that he could find to do like this countdown and blast the Earth into a wasteland, it gets the attention of the One Who Laughs, who then in a last-ditch effort throws some of his baby worlds out there to try to stop the heroes from finishing their job. And really, I say the heroes, but really it's the heroes and the villains, it's everybody. But amongst those left, they know the One Who Laughs has sent his defenses for the multiverse which he created when Superman senses it coming and he gives everyone the announcement, like, heads up. But like, as we get these new characters like incoming from the Multiverse Who Laughs, we're also reminded of Earth Zero Diana's speech, which was the complete opposite of the speech from the Robin King's Diana. Because the Robin King, his Diana said to fight because there's always a tomorrow, but Earth Zero Diana, she said fight like there is no tomorrow. Which definitely is going to give us a crazy match up between these guys and everything coming out of the multiverse that laughs. And so now real quick, I want to give a special shout out to all the Patreons. Thank you guys for all your support. And for anyone who's new here who wants more information on how to support the channel, I got a link below to where you can go to patreon.com/dopespill. But that'll do it for this one, guys. Let me know your thoughts down in the comments below, and we'll do it again in the next one. All right, later.